Okay, the next item of business is a statement by Jenny O'Ruth on Scottish Government response to the independent review of qualifications and assessment. The Cabinet Secretary will take questions at the end of the statement and therefore there should be no interventions or interruptions. And I call on the Cabinet Secretary up to 10 minutes, please.
Presiding Officer, I'm pleased to set out the Scottish Government's next steps on qualifications reform today in response to the recommendations from the independent review of qualifications and assessment. And I would like to thank Professor Louise Hayward and the Independent Review Group once again for the significant care and attention undertaken in producing the final report. When I became Cabinet Secretary last year, numerous reports were sitting on my desk with a significant programme of reform to consider. Ensuring that I took the right decisions for our young people, the teachers who support them and wider society has been my primary concern throughout. That is why I paused elements of the Education Reform Programme, taking the time to really listen to the views of school pupils, teachers and parents groups alike has been critical to informing the Government's response set out in the independent review. Presiding Officer, the pandemic has changed our schools. In that context, which has been compounded by constrained public finances, cannot be ignored. Challenges with attendance, attainment, relationships and behaviour are the reality for our schools every day. It is my job to recognise that and to shape a response accordingly. It is clear that there are a wide range of views on qualification reform. Some continue to call for radical changes next week, whilst others favour a more pragmatic approach, recognising the other pressures facing schools post-COVID. For some time now, there has been an understandable focus on the senior phase and qualifications pathways. But we must be mindful that qualifications reform is not in itself a panacea. Our ambition to improve Scottish education must encompass high-quality learning and teaching at all levels, in early years, primary, and in our secondary schools across Scotland. Indeed, if we narrowly consider the senior phase of our children's education, that being S4 to S6, within a silo, then it will be too late in a child's educational journey to make the necessary interventions. To that end, I will set out a fresh national approach to educational improvement later this year. The new plan will set out the short, medium and longer term priorities for Scottish education with a clear focus on excellence and equity through improvement. Further, I believe that a new independent inspectorate will have a key role to play in driving improvement. It is essential within that new opportunity that the local support that is needed for schools is there, particularly given that the statutory responsibility for the delivery of education currently rests in the hands of local authorities. To that end, a national thematic inspection on local authority approaches to school improvement is underway, with inspectors due to visit every council in Scotland. This will ensure that nationally we have a better understanding of priority areas for improvement and examples of effective support and intervention. And it will further support local authorities to address local variability, as evidenced in this year's exam results, and enhance educational equality. Our approach to improving education must be built on the existing commitment and professionalism of Scotland's teachers. And that is why, over the coming weeks, I will lead a series of regional events, initially with secondary head teachers, followed by engagement with primary and early years teachers. They will provide further opportunities to test a more focused improvement plan for both local and national government to support. The evolution of Scotland's approach to assessment in the senior phase will be an integral part of our wider plans to improve the curriculum. The curriculum improvement cycle is already underway, beginning with maths and numeracy. And this means that, for the first time, there will be a systematic approach to ensuring that curriculum in Scotland remains relevant, forward-looking, and clarifies the role of knowledge and ultimately supports high-quality teaching, learning and progression. Communications updating on progress with the curriculum improvement work will start later this month, and I will write to the Education and Skills Committee in due course, setting out further details and associated timescales for delivery in every curricular area. Fundamentally, this approach will be underpinned by teacher expertise. Subject specialists must and will lead on improving and updating Scotland's curriculum. Curriculum should drive qualifications, not the other way around. That is why the qualifications content will also be updated to ensure strong alignment between the broad general education and the senior phase. And whilst curriculum improvement and qualifications reform are an integral part of our education reform programme, We will also see our national bodies reformed to support the changes and improvements that are required. The effective leadership of those bodies will be key, and as Parliament may be aware, a new chair of the SQA was appointed in December of last year to lead its transition to Qualifications Scotland. This week, both the substantive Chief Inspector and the Chief Executive of Education Scotland posts were advertised on a permanent basis. And these three organisations will play a pivotal role in curriculum improvement and qualification development. Leadership of all three will be essential in garnering trust and credibility with Scotland's young people, teachers and parents and carers. Presiding Officer, I agree with the report's recommendation that the balance of assessment methods in the senior phase should change to have less reliance on high-stakes final exams. And this means that, in the future, internal and continuous assessment will contribute a greater percentage of a final grade. This will support more young people to successfully evidence their learning, and it will also act to increase the resilience of our overall approach to assessment. I want to be clear that taking steps to rebalance assessment does not mean that exams will be removed. And I can therefore confirm that examinations will remain part of our overall national approach and will not be removed from all National 5 courses. I know from direct engagement as Cabinet Secretary that many young people prefer examinations over continuous assessment. And as evidenced by the teacher survey published earlier this year, many secondary school teachers who responded support the retention of exams as a means of applying a consistent and objective standard. There are, however, a number of practical national courses where an exam might not be needed. So the qualifications body are currently consulting on whether or not courses such as National 5 and Higher Fashion and Technology, National 5 Practical Cookery and National 5 Practical Electronics should have an examination component. I also support the view that the senior phase has, over time, become overly complex. Now, it is right that young people are now able to choose from a wide variety of learning opportunities than previously. However, it's also vitally important that all young people have a clear and coherent senior phase offer, which aligns pathways available in both higher and further education and on into employment. The Scottish Government therefore supports the view that a degree of rationalisation of the senior phase will allow us to ensure clearer pathways which are less confusing for young people. Learning from our past experience with unit assessments and associated issues around teacher workload, we will also further explore how modularisation of graded national courses can be reintroduced so that pupils have maximum flexibility to build credit as they progress. With regards to interdisciplinary learning, or IDL as it is known, I recognise the desire, including from some young people themselves, for IDL opportunities to be more consistently available. It is that consistency, that parity of opportunity, which is important. And indeed, I am conscious of the recent publication by HMIE on curriculum design in Scotland, which stated that there remains a lack of clarity regarding high-quality IDL. I am therefore of the view that more work is required if IDL is to become a required part of the senior phase. A refreshed national working group, chaired by a senior secondary school leader, will therefore bring together all relevant parties already active in this space. This group will lead a new phase of work with the objective of better determining the place of IDL in secondary schools while ensuring an equitable, high-quality offer for all young people. This exercise will also help to expand our shared knowledge as to the ways in which IDL could be embedded into a school's curriculum, including in respect of timetabling, whilst also considering accreditation. The Scottish Government supports the principle that young people should receive recognition for their wider learning, and we will therefore explore how best to recognise such achievement with a range of stakeholders, including young people. And in doing so, we will need to work through significant concerns which have been raised, mainly that such a step would further entrench and exacerbate social inequity. In considering the next steps, that is the principal barrier which I believe must be addressed and overcome. To facilitate greater recognition of wider achievement, I agree that the development of a national digital profile would benefit young people by helping them consolidate their learning. A profile within the My World of Work platform, managed by Skills Development Scotland, has been established and will now be further improved in conjunction with both teachers and young people. This will ensure consistent and cost-free access to all young people in Scotland to a digital profile, a key recommendation from the report. The central proposal from the independent review is that Scotland should adopt a Scottish Diploma of Achievement as a senior phase leaving certificate, and whilst supportive of the development of a leaving certificate as a shared longer-term goal for Scottish education, more work is needed to determine its exact content and how it would operate. We will work with schools to consider how programmes of learning, IDL and wider achievement could be combined as a more holistic illustration of a pupil's achievements. Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government is firmly of the view that teachers require more time if they are able to accept greater responsibility for formal assessment. And with that in mind, the Scottish Government remains fully committed to the delivery of our commitment to reduce class contact time by 90 minutes per week. This is a matter which I know the Scottish Negotiating Committee is prioritising, which members will recall is a tripartite body consisting of the trade unions, COSLA and Scottish Government. And it is imperative that all parties bring the necessary focus to delivery as quickly and as effectively as possible, because we cannot reform our education system without giving teachers more time. For my part, I know that there are parts of the country in which we could begin to roll out reduced class contact time tomorrow. Getting an agreement on this from the SNCT is therefore imperative to allow us to move at pace. Allied to this, and to help teachers focus on learning and teaching, we've launched a CivTech challenge which invites bids designed to reduce teacher workload via the use of AI. Finally, our teachers must be the leaders of change that we need to see. Teachers must be empowered to lead the improvements within our education system, and that is why an experienced secondary head teacher will be seconded into the new qualifications body to lead a new chapter of meaningful engagement with Scotland's teachers. Presiding Officer, the actions on qualifications reform that I'm setting out today seek to achieve a balance between ambition and action that is focused, pragmatic and deliverable, given the resources available to national and local government and to schools themselves. They build directly on the hard work, success and the creativity that is already evident in every school in Scotland. This approach to evolving qualifications and assessment will deliver a fairer and a more credible system that enhances learning and teaching while supporting better outcomes for young people. But this is only one part of the improvement picture. A much more holistic and longer-term approach, which takes account of the changes in our schools post-pandemic, is required to drive the totality of improvements that must support better outcomes for our children and young people. Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I note the length of the statement exceeded the 10 minutes. I do intend to, though, protect the 20 minutes or so for questions. I would encourage any member wishing to ask a question to press the request to speak buttons now. And I call, firstly, Liam Kerr.
Very grateful, and I thank the Cabinet Secretary for advance sight of her statement, and I welcome that at last Parliament is seeing responses drip through from the Government to the many excellent reports, although I wonder whether such a fragmented rather than a holistic approach is the optimum way to address the reforms that are needed. On which note, the Hayward reports, the Royal Society of Edinburgh, Professor Muir and many others have all been clear that what's needed is a long-term strategic vision for the future of Scotland's education system, from which actions, plans and priorities can be driven. But there isn't such a vision or destination laid out here. So having chosen to ignore these experts' calls for a proper strategic destination, how confident can the Cabinet Secretary be that a piecemeal rather than a visionary approach will deliver the outcomes the experts tell us are needed? Secondly, the Cabinet Secretary makes no mention of the upfront and ongoing costs of these reforms, working groups, plans and indeed delivery of reduced class contact time. Last week we heard the Cabinet Secretary justify the shameful breach of the SNP's manifesto promise on school meals by reference to a lack of money. So Cabinet Secretary, how much do all these plans set out in this statement cost, and from where will the sum be drawn? And finally, school leaders advise that, to quote the Cabinet Secretary, the challenges with attendance, attainment, relationships and behaviour would improve should the curricular offer be broader and more appealing to all learners rather than perhaps traditional academic pathways might have been. So what plans does the Scottish Government have to support schools to offer a breadth of curriculum that's suitable to all learners?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for his question. I think he raises some really pertinent points, Presiding Officer. I'm not, first of all, going to make any apologies for building in extra time to consult with the teaching profession. You know, when I was first appointed Presiding Officer, I was told that there was a real ambition in the system for radical change now. And actually, through my engagement with Scotland's secondary teachers over the course of the last year, that is not a shared view across the profession. I think that's really important. And of course, he will have reflected on the views, well, I hear the member chuntering, but if you would listen, I hear the... Thank you.
Could we listen to both the questions and the responses with a degree of courtesy and respect, Cabinet Secretary?
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The member asked about a longer-term strategic vision. I don't think today was the moment to set out that longer-term strategic vision because, of course, the content of today's statement is responding to a review that looks specifically at the senior phase level of qualifications. But what I have said in my statement and what I have said in the government's written response, which I appreciate members have perhaps not had time to acquaint themselves with, is that I will set out that longer-term ambition for Scottish education around improvement. And it is hugely important that that does not narrowly look only at senior phase. It must look at early years, it must look at primary education in the totality. The second point of the member's question, Presiding Officer, I think relates to funding. And of course, worthwhile pointing out that the actions I've set out today are pragmatic, they are proportionate. He talks to the issues highlighted in last week's debate, which relate largely to funding. I am very cognisant of that as Cabinet Secretary. It is a feature of my thinking around about the practical deliverability of qualifications reform when the public finances are as constrained in Scotland as they are at the current time. The member may wish to reflect on why that may be the case. But of course, ongoing qualifications development is a key function of the current qualifications body and will remain a key function of Qualifications Scotland. So much of this work will be costed and funded as part of core operational activity already being undertaken by the current qualifications body. Finally, Presiding Officer, the member asked about curriculum offer. Of course, through education reform, I will be working directly with schools, but with the new qualifications body, with Education Scotland, on how we can help to support better curricular offer, I think, across the country. We see variance across the country at the current time. I think we need to look at how we can deliver a consistent and equitable offer for all young people.
I'm Duncan Glancy.
Officer, and I thank the Cabinet Secretary for advance sight of her statement and for meeting with opposition spokespeople this morning. The expectation and aspiration on reform is rightly huge. But I have to say, I don't think the announcements today match that, or the appetite, or the need for change. Because let's remember how we got here. Clear issues within the structure of the curriculum. Movement between the broad general education and the senior phase implemented poorly by the government, leading to fewer choices and incoherence. Misalignment between the curriculum and the purpose of assessment. But rather than a concrete plan to address these concerns, what we have today is not the bold vision for education that experts are calling for, and nothing that will give much needed certainty to teachers or pupils, just an indication that that or a plan, another plan, will come in December. So in the interests of getting the clarity for the people waiting for answers, can I ask the Cabinet Secretary four things? Has she modelled the impact of these changes on teacher workload? What does she mean by rationalisation of the senior phase? Does she have confidence in our education bill that it creates the structures and instills the leadership needed to reform the system the way that she wants? And does the Cabinet Secretary really believe that the announcement today meets the scale
Cabinet
of the challenge?
Secretary. Cabinet Secretary.
I'm sorry, I didn't quite catch the final question from Ms Duncan Glancy there, but I think worthwhile recalling the views from the Scottish Secondary Teachers Association, who have said today the SSTA welcomes the Cabinet Secretary's statement on the government's response to the Hayward Review. The statement maps a way forward in making the cultural changes required in secondary schools in regard to national qualifications and a teacher-led continuous assessment approach. Many SSTA members will be pleased to hear there will be an element of external assessment at NAT5 in the short term, and that any future developments will be trialled and piloted before implementation. And one of the points I think Ms Duncan Glancy raises about how the practicalities of this will work in schools. Having been in school the last time the government introduced curriculum reform, I know that there are challenges often with how that can work on the ground. I think it is important that the government works to resource piloting of measures that are outlined in the response to ensure that teachers have the necessary additionality that may be in terms of resources, for example, to make sure that this can work. I've also, Presiding Officer, talked to a number of different actions that are already underway today, and it is worthwhile saying that the work we will be undertaking in relation to qualifications reform does not sit in a silo separately to the wider work that Mr Day is leading on in relation to skills reform. I will chair the meeting of the Curriculum Improvement and Qualifications Reform Assurance Group to ensure progress is being made and our shared timetable is being clearly communicated. She mentioned teacher workload, and of course I spoke in my response, and there is more detail on this in the government's written response, about the need to look, for example, at AI to reduce teacher workload. I think there are opportunities there, and of course the government has commissioned further work to that end, because it's hugely important that the reintroduction of continuous assessment does not overburden teachers. But I am resolutely focused, having given the update to Parliament today, on reducing teacher class contact, because I'm very clear, Presiding Officer, teachers in our secondary schools in particular need time to have an opportunity to engage with the changes that are being proposed.
Thank you. I'm conscious with the previous statement we weren't able to call everybody that wanted to ask a question because of the length of questions and indeed responses. We've got 12 and a half minutes and 10 colleagues who want to get in, so the questions and indeed responses will need to be tighter. Fulton McGregor to be followed by Ros McCall.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Over recent times, in particular since the pandemic, when I have visited schools in my constituency, students, including those at St Andrews High in Coatbridge, for example, have often overwhelmingly expressed a preference for continued assessment over final written exam models. A progression of that, of course, has been featured in this year's programme for government. Can the Cabinet Secretary say any more about Scottish Government's plans for the diversification of assessment models?
Cabinet Secretary.
So, Presiding Officer, I accept that the balance of assessment in the senior phase should now change so that there is less reliance on high-stakes final examinations, with internal and continuous assessment contributing to a greater percentage of the final grade. This will really help to support more young people to successfully evidence their learning, and for many it will also reduce the stress that Fulton McGregor spoke to that is often associated with final examinations. As I made clear in my statement, taking those steps to rebalance assessment doesn't mean that exams will be removed as a matter of course. Many studies from around the world evidence the value of examinations in applying that consistent and objective standard as part of an overall approach. That said, as has been referenced in this year's programme for government, there may be practical national courses, as I alluded to today, where an exam might not be needed. The qualifications body is looking at that rationalisation exercise at the current time.
Ros McCall to be followed by Ben McPherson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I note the Cabinet Secretary is committed to reducing teacher contact by 90 minutes within the statement, and it's been mentioned in the Chamber. This was promised in the SNP 2021 manifesto, and we're now in 2024. With about 18 months to the next election, time is seriously running out for so many of the government promises. So can the Cabinet Secretary guarantee that this will actually happen?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for her question. She will know that reducing teacher contact was a key feature of my statement today, quite deliberately, because I believe firmly that we cannot deliver qualification reform without creating the headspace, the time for teachers to engage with that process. And throughout my response, I've been very keen to ensure that our secondary teachers in particular are leading on qualification development. She asked a question about the deliverability of the 90 minutes, and the point I made in my statement is that that will require the agreement of the tripartite, so that Scottish Government, and the teaching trade unions. I am going to play as full a part as I can as Cabinet Secretary in that process. And I said in my statement today, I could go tomorrow if we could get an agreement around about the purpose of that time, because there are enough teachers in certain parts of the country right now to get going. So I want us to get going. I hope the member hears the urgency to which I attach this with, and I look forward to working with all partners through the SNCT on delivering that change to teachers' working conditions, which I think will be to the benefit of our young people.
Ben McPherson to be followed by Martin Whitfield.
I welcome the statement and the time that the Cabinet Secretary is taking to effectively implement and collegiately do so and future-proof the system. In that regard, could the Cabinet Secretary set out a bit more about how the curriculum improvement cycle will interact with the work on qualifications reform?
Cabinet Secretary.
So, Presiding Officer, as I set out in my opening statement, that evolution of Scotland's approach to assessment in the senior phase needs to be integral to our wider plans to improve the totality of Scotland's curriculum. So the curriculum improvement cycle, as I announced last year, is already underway. We started with maths and numeracy, and for the first time there will be that systematic approach to ensuring the curriculum in Scotland remains relevant and updated. And I should also put on the record, Presiding Officer, that work is being led by a secondary head teacher, a maths specialist to trade, which I think is hugely important in building credibility in terms of the approach we are taking. But we know that curriculum should not drive qualifications, or should rather drive qualifications, not the other way around. So qualifications content needs also to be updated in line with the curriculum improvement work to ensure we do have that alignment between the BGE and the senior phase. And for me, that was a matter that was not resolved during the last time we considered qualification reform. So I think the practicalities actually of things like timetabling are really important in this process to ensure we get the culture change in the senior phase that we need to see, and arguably that we didn't see the last time we reformed the qualification system.
Martin Whitfield to be followed by Rona Mackay.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer. The Cabinet Secretary has quoted others reference to the announcement today. She may be interested to know that the Children's Commissioner has just said that the Scottish Government's long-anticipated response to the Hayward Review was an opportunity to advance the change that young people desperately need. Yet instead of committing to the effort of a comprehensive reform, today's announcement was little more than tentative steps. What's your comment on that?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank the member for his question. Of course, the Children's Commissioner made comments last week, and if she would like to meet with me on any of these issues, my door is always open. What I would say, though, is that I met with the Scottish Youth Parliament this morning and engaged heavily with them on the plans, but also on next steps. And the views of young people have and continue to be vital to informing the approach that we are taking to evolving Scotland's qualifications offer. So young people were involved through the independent review, through the Scottish Youth Parliament, who led a group bringing together a diverse range of young people. There was also significant engagement with young people undertaken through the National Discussion on Education. As I mentioned, I spoke directly to many young people on qualifications reform throughout the past year who have a divergence of views on this, and I met with the SYP only this morning. I'm very clear that the views, the knowledge and the lived experience of those studying for qualifications are really essential to delivering qualifications in pupils' best interests. That's why we're ensuring a stronger voice for young people and adult learners with the formal governance arrangements in Qualifications Scotland, looking at the establishment of that learners panel, which I think will be hugely important and quite a significant shift in relation to how the qualifications body currently operates.
Rona Mackay to be followed by Ross Grey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In all these matters, the role of the teacher, of course, will be absolutely vital. Could the Cabinet Secretary set out how she'll ensure both that the voice of teachers are heard throughout this process and how teachers will be supported to deliver this approach?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm very clear that teachers, including those in the Gaelic medium education sector, need to be meaningfully engaged in reform and empowered to lead the improvements that we all want to see. And to that end, as I intimated in my statement, Presiding Officer, a secondary head teacher will be seconded into the qualifications body, which I think is hugely important. That meaningful engagement with teachers is already happening in terms of driving curriculum improvement work with the co-creation approach that's being led by Andy Brown, as the work on maths and numeracy will deliver improvements in that curriculum area. I accept also, I think, in the response to Ros McCall, that teachers will need time and they will need space to engage with reform. And I remain very committed to the delivery of that commitment around reducing class contact time. I'm keen to inject some urgency into this work, Presiding Officer. I see that as the next step on how we can create the time that's needed for teachers to fully engage with the changes that have been proposed.
Ross Greer to be followed by Claire Haughey.
Thank you. The Scottish Greens secured this review after the 2020 SQA scandal because we know that Scotland's Victorian-era exam system isn't fit for purpose. So we're disappointed that it's largely not being taken forward. We do welcome the fact that there will be more continuous assessment, but surely this should sit alongside fewer exams. It appears the government are layering one on top of the other. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, will this not just massively increase the already unsustainable workload of secondary teachers?
Secretary.
I thank the member for his point. I think in relation to his point in regard to fewer exams, in my statement I did talk to the degree of rationalisation, which, forgive me, Pam Duncan-Glancy also spoke to me about, and that is us looking at the numbers of courses that are currently delivered in schools and asking the question as to whether or not they might be more appropriately delivered elsewhere, for example in college settings. We are looking at a range of practical subjects already. Qualifications Scotland is going to reduce the number of examinations, for example, in practical subjects. That work is already underway. But for me, the biggest change that's being proposed today is that we will not have an approach that looks at high-stakes final examinations. So having a smaller percentage, for example, associated with the final examination will put less stress on our young people. And fundamentally, I think that's really important. It will lead to better approaches to learning and teaching as assessment evidence is gathered throughout the academic year, and hopefully a move away from what we have historically referred to as the two-term dash. The ethos of curriculum for excellence and that of the senior phase have not, to my mind, been able to interlink correctly together. And part of that we need to resolve through appropriate support on timetabling, but throughout all of the recommendations that have been, you know, the government has responded to today, I want teacher voice to be at the heart of that. And I've been very clear in every single angle that we will have teachers leading on the developments we need to see. And I want to continue that work with the profession, because it's only through working with them we can drive the improvements we need to see for our young people.
Claire Haughey to be followed by Willie Rennie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As the Hayward Review states, the relationship between poverty and achievement is an international challenge. Does the Cabinet Secretary share my concerns that decisions made at Westminster and the UK Prime Minister's recent warning that things will get worse will keep more children and families in poverty, the impact of which will be felt across their classrooms?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I thank the member for her question. I think it is important that financial context is ultimately absolutely relevant to what I am able to do as Education Secretary in relation to education reform. And of course, we know that UK public finances are facing severe challenges with £22 billion of a gap in funding and with the upcoming UK budget expected to be painful. But within that context, we have had to manage public finances, and in spite of that challenging context, we continue to prioritise investment in our children and young people's education. We have the highest spend per pupil in the UK, the highest teacher-pupil ratio, and continued investment through the Scottish Attainment Challenge and pupil equity funding. That is making a difference, but undoubtedly, it is becoming much more challenging with funding cuts being driven from elsewhere. That is also impacting on the level of ambition I can have around curriculum and qualification reform, Presiding Officer.
Willie Rennie to be followed by Sue Webber.
It's been over six reports and 8 years since the deep problems in education were identified by Nicola Sturgeon, who isn't here yet again today, despite it being her defining mission. With the bulk of the recommendations rejected or stuck into working groups, does the Cabinet Secretary think her statement matches the scale of the problem identified? And does the Cabinet Secretary, as she sounds so sceptical, wondering why she is putting so much of the personal pathway, the diploma, the interdisciplinary learning into working groups that she has established. Why is she so sceptical when she's doing those working groups?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Mr Rennie for his question. I think 8 years ago, back in 2014, I was in a classroom and I was delivering new qualifications at that time, 8 years ago. So I know how this works. I understand how it operates in our schools, and I think it needs to be dealt with really carefully. And when he talks about matching the scale of ambition, I'm thinking about the pragmatic deliverability of this in our classrooms, and I will always have that at the heart of my decision-making in this role, because I think it's really important we get this right for Scotland's children and young people. I could come to the Chamber today and accept all of the recommendations, but I don't have a budget to resource it, as the member knows. We had a debate to that end only last week. He talks about working groups. Well, yes, I think they are important. I think it is important that teachers who have skills in these areas, like interdisciplinary learning, and of course, in reading the government's response, he will see a number of schools referenced there who have real skill sets in this area, are able to pilot approaches that others may be able to learn from. But I'm also cognizant of the HMI reports that say there is variability across the country at the current time in relation to IDL. So we need to make sure there's an equitable and a consistent offer. There isn't at the current time. I'm taking small steps forward in a number of these areas through working groups, but fundamentally through teacher leadership, because I think that's the right way to deliver qualification reform.
And finally, Sue Webber.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In your statement, Cabinet Secretary, you believe that a new independent inspectorate will have a key role to play in driving improvement. At committee yesterday, not one of the witnesses who appeared shared the same view, in that they questioned the independence of the new chief inspector, suggesting instead that it should be non-ministerial office and report to Parliament, not to ministers. They're concerned that the role appears to be report orientated and focus on the inspection of establishments. And critically, the definition and purpose of inspection was missing. Cabinet Secretary, do you agree that the legislation needs to be amended to reflect these serious flaws that would ensure the effectiveness of the Chief Inspector role from day one, and to ensure what you have outlined here today will actually be achieved?
Through the Chair, Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, today's statement is about the Hayward Review. I accept the member has asked me about wider work, of which relates to a piece of legislation that I will be giving evidence to her committee on in the coming weeks. I think that the approach we have taken in relation to the separation of HMI from the inspectorate mirrors that which existed prior to the joining of as was Learning Teaching Scotland and the inspectorate. So it is an approach that was previously in the system and that teachers will be familiar with. If the member wishes to take forward amendments, that of course is in her gift. I'm happy to work with or to listen to any concerns the committee may have. But it was a recommendation that the inspectorate was removed from Education Scotland. That is something the government is now legislating to deliver on, and I would hope that members would welcome that.
Thank you. That concludes this item of business. There'll be a brief pause before we move to the next item of business. The live front benches to change.